How are you? Montgomery, Gregory, Elise, how are you? Natalie, Philippa, welcome everybody. Catherine, Natalie, welcome everybody, folks. Good to see you all. Hope you're all doing well. We're here in Dublin City, right here by the River Liffey. It's a very cold day today. It's windy, and its temperatures have really dropped compared to what they have been like over recent months. But I guess that's the way it is. We were spoiled with the summer here in Dublin, where it was absolutely beautiful, beautiful, great warm temperatures, around 25 to 30 every day, so it was really nice. Getting back to normal now, though. Hi, Benjamin. Katia, how are you? Pumpkin spice. I love it. Very appropriate for this time of year. Pumpkin for Halloween. Pumpkin spice. Great to see us all, folks. How's all doing? Where's everybody calling in from? What's the weather like where you guys are from? We're going to be starting a tour in a little over 2 minutes. We're going to take you around the River Liffey here for a little bit, show you around some of the bridges, and then we'll make our way into Temple Bar, the great nightclub here of Dublin, where all the action is with all the tourists, and great atmosphere in there. We'll hop into a bar at the end of the tour, so we'll go into the Temple Bar pub, a little bit of music for a bit of crack. Show luggage crack, music and fun, folks. Get excited. No sound. No sound. How's it for everybody else? Can everybody else hear? I have sound. You need to refresh then, Natalie. It's fine here. Declan said, oh, yeah, Declan, good to see you. I actually met Declan in person there on Sunday. I did a in-person tour for a meetup group, and Declan was on that tour. First time meeting him. He lives in Drogheda, probably about 45 minutes from here. Good to see you. Good to see you, Declan. Julie, how are you? Suzanne, how are you? Good to see you. Suzanne's coming here on the 19th of October. So just a little over 2 weeks, I guess. Or exactly 2 weeks, maybe. Not sure. Helen, how are you? Good stuff. Suzanne, yeah. She's excited about coming over. Natalie. Oh, there. Okay, so the sound and the vision, everything's good, folks. It's very windy out. You can see the trees blowing, very windy. And because we're beside the Liffey, I hope we don't get any wind, too much feedback from the wind. I do have a windshield on my microphone, but it doesn't. If the wind is really bad, it can still affect the sound. Just let me know. You're perfect now. Thanks, Natalie. Appreciate it. Tundra and hail and Drogheda. It probably is going to rain here too, because just over an hour ago it was lashing rain. And then the sun came out, but looks like the great clouds are coming back again, so it may rain shortly. Hopefully it won't. But that's the way it goes. This is Ireland, folks. You got to expect this kind of weather. And to the Morrison Hotel. Yes, indeed. We'll be going past the Morrison Hotel, Suzanne, where Suzanne is staying. She's staying there and staying in Hoth also. So I'll be doing the tour in Hoth later on this month. So we're starting a tour here, folks. Welcome, everybody. Good to see you all. Hope you're all well. Poppy, how are you? Good to see you. Welcome, everybody, folks. I'm just trying to adjust this camera for a little bit here. Okay. Okay, it's all good there. So we're here by the River Liffey, folks. The River Liffey runs through the centre of Dublin, separates north inner city from south inner city Dublin. And there's 21 bridges that run along the River Liffey in the city of Dublin. So Elsie, Elise, recognised this because Elise was here in August. She was there on the Patrick Toomey tour of Ireland. And she spent a couple of nights here in the Gresham Hotel, just down the street here on O'Connell Street. And so she knows this spot well. Your stomping grounds. There you go. Welcome, Linda. Good to see you. Cindy, how are you? So folks, this is O'Connell Bridge right here. And what's really unique about this bridge is that its width is 50 meters and its length is 45 meters. So the width is longer than its length, which is quite incredible. I don't know if you see this anywhere else where the width of the bridge is longer than its length. But that's the case right here at O'Connell Bridge, formerly known as, excuse me, Carlisle Bridge, from the first Earl of Carlisle. It was renamed for Daniel O'Connell in 1882. And it was designed by the great architect James Gandon. He was one of the great architects here in Dublin and throughout Ireland back in the 1700s, late 1700s. And if you look at this dome further down there, the dome building, I'll zoom in. That's the custom house. He also designed that as well, along with the four courts, the King's Inn, the old Irish Parliament. He was part of that as well. So this guy is a prolific architect, James Gannon, who has said designed this bridge right here as well. Now, in the year, on the 26th of June 1933, there was 500,000 people descending on this bridge right here for the Eucharistic Congress that took place here in Dublin. As I say, on the 26th of June 1933, there was 500,000 people on the bridge. Quite extraordinary how it could hold. There was ocean liners. Many ocean liners came in here to the Liffey. A lot of these bridges wouldn't have been built at that time. So ocean liners would have come up very close to this bridge at that time for the Eucharistic Congress, as I say, in 1933. 12 ocean liners came visited Dublin to accommodate the huge numbers of people who came to the city of Dublin for the event. Now, there was a man by the name of Arthur Fields who was on this bridge. Locally, he was locally known as the man on the bridge. And he took more than 182,000 photographs on this bridge of pedestrians from 1930 right up until 1980. Now, people would come by and they'd ask him to take pictures of them as well, because he would then go home and he would, what's the word for photography? When you do someone's photograph, anyway, he would bring back the photograph for them a couple of days later and they could frame it and put it in their house and so forth. Known as the man on the bridge, Arthur Fields. Now, this is the great Daniel O'Connell. This is the statue. This is the beginning of O'Connell Street. This is Dublin's main thoroughfare here. It's the widest street in Europe, folks. O'Connell Street right here, named after this great man, one of the great Irish people in Irish history, a great patriot, Daniel O'Connell. He was born at Carrickshaven in County Kerry. If you were on that tour, I was down there, myself and Hazel, around August, mid-August or whatever, and we did a great tour of Daniel O'Connell's hometown, Carrickshaven. And actually, in Carrickshaven, you have the Daniel O'Connell Memorial Church, and it happens to be the only church in all of Ireland that's not named after a saint, but named after a lay person. This man, Daniel O'Connell. Quite extraordinary. And I'll try and get a better view of it here. I'm going to cross the road because this is prime time right now. There's lots of people around, so I got to try and take my chances when I can when the man is green to cross the road. So O'Connell was known as the Liberator or the Catholic Emancipator. He was an Irish politician. And sorry about the buses, folks. He was an Irish politician. He was a lawyer. And he founded the Catholic Association in 1823 to help the poor Irish Catholic tenant farmers to get economic rights and economic reform. He would have been one of the early day civil rights leaders of the world. And he was the first Catholic Lord Mayor of Dublin in 1841. And he really was a great man. Now, he actually got legislative freedom for Ireland, where no Catholics before his time were allowed to be members of Parliament, were allowed to enter government. But he found a loophole in that, and he actually, no Catholics had ever even bothered running for election because they thought they wouldn't get into Parliament. But there was no legislation against you running for election. And if you did get voted in, then you will become a member of Parliament. So that's where he ran for the Clare election. He won it in a landslide, and he ended up entering politics. And as I say, he did so much improvements for the lives of the poor Irish people at the time, who are mostly, as I say, tenant farmers, who were basically discriminated against by their British landlords and so forth. But he paved the way for things, for violations to be overturned, and make life a lot easier for the poor Irish tenant farmers of the day. Now, he's a very religious man. He was born in 1775 in Carrickshaven, County Kerry, as I say. And in 1845, he died on his way to Genoa. On his way to Rome. He died in Genoa on his way to Rome to be blessed by the Pope. And his wishes were for his his heart to be brought to Rome, his body to be buried here in Dublin Glasnevin Cemetery, and his soul to heaven. And ironically, he is the man that actually set up or established the Glasnevin Cemetery. And the biggest the biggest grave or ever, if you like, in there is actually the O'Connell Tower, where Daniel O'Connell and all of his family are buried right in the tower. You can go right up to the top of the tower. It's about 70 metres high, and you can look over the whole skyline of Dublin. So if you had to ask anybody who was the greatest patriot or the most important political figure or the most important person in the history of Ireland, you would say one of two men or maybe two men. This man right here, Daniel O'Connell, or you would say Michael Collins. And I did a feature on Michael Collins in his hometown of Clonakilty just a few weeks back. They all wore wigs back then, James. Is that my buddy James messing around again? They all wore wigs back then in Parliament. You know that. We're moving on, folks. This is a bachelor's walk that are going in now. Now, most of the streets along by the River Liffey here are known as quays. Like over there, you got Aston Quay further over there. That's more of a bus hub where you can get buses going all over the country, and also buses to other suburban towns and villages in Dublin. But it's a real big bus hub. Ignore this fella James R, folks. I think that's my buddy James is on there. Whatever he says, don't even listen. Don't even read it. Thanks very much. Nora, how are you? Francis Michael Collins, more so, definitely Fraser. Michael Collins, more so than Eamon De Valera. 100 times more so. History favours Collins in a much more favourable position than De Valera, that's for sure. De Valera lived a lot longer than Collins. Collins was only 31 years old when he died on 20. He was shot dead on 22nd of August, 1922, 100 years ago today. That's the year also that we got our independence. So here we are celebrating our 100 years of independence from Britain this year, 2022. This is his bachelor's walk. This is a great place here called the Arlington Bar and Restaurant. Now, I want to do a tour in here. I'm waiting back to hear back from them, because they have a night called Celtic Nights or Celtic Legends or whatever it is. And it's just fantastic Irish dancing and Irish traditional music. And I really, really want to do a tour in there. So I'm still waiting back for the manager to get back in touch with me. But I'd love to live stream. It would be a fantastic night. You'd really enjoy it, folks. It's brilliant. So this is the boardwalk, as you say, on the River Liffey. We're looking for straight ahead here at the Hapenny Bridge. Tell you a little bit more about that when we move up to it. All the coffee shops along the boardwalk are closed at this time. They usually open very early in the morning, so they close probably about 5 o'clock or so. So now, it can be sometimes dangerous in this boardwalk. You can be have some, especially later at night, there's a some homeless people might be hanging out here, so you just got to be careful and stuff. Nothing against homeless, but it's just that, you know, they need money, and they'll get it whatever way they can. There's actually a Liffey swim that takes place here, folks, every August. Now, this river used to be very much polluted, not today. It used to be absolutely disgusting. Not so long ago, up to about 25 years ago, it was really filthy, and it stunk like hell. It even has it in song. If you ever listen to a song called Summer in Dublin, as a Liffey, and it stank like hell. So anyway, this swim is about 1.5 kilometres. Goes all the way down the River Liffey, starting around just before the Hapenny Bridge, the Liffey swim. It's been going on for about 70 years, I believe. 70 years. Bagatelle, that's right, Declan. And the Liffey has a stank like hell. So there you go. There's also kayaking that takes place right here on the bridge. But I think it's probably finished for the season. The weather is going to be much colder, and the river, the Liffey, will be much rougher as well. So it looks like all the kayaks are gone. They're not usually here. But it would be a lot of fun going on that. There's also boat cruisers leaving from here, canoeing and that kind of stuff here on the Liffey as well. And now have a look at this bridge straight ahead of us, folks. The two most famous bridges here across the Liffey, the one I just showed you, was O'Connell Bridge. And the next most famous is this one right here, are probably equally as famous as we see the birds. They're running away when they see me. They're flying away when they see me. They're camera shy, folks, the seagulls. But anyway, what a beautiful, clean river it is now. Yes, Nora, that's for sure. Definitely. So, the Hapenny Bridge, made of cast iron. It's a pedestrian bridge. When it was built, it was the first pedestrian bridge over the River Liffey. At the time, the rest would have had, you know, horse and carts going over them and so forth. And now, before this was built, as I say, in 1816, and this Hapenny Bridge. But before that, there was a man by the name of Willie Walsh, and he had a little boat, ferry boat, that he ferried people across from one side to the other. Now, he was told that he'd have to stop operations because the boat was very much in disrepair and was very dangerous. But they gave him an opportunity. They told him, this is the Dublin Corporation, and they told him that he could build a bridge if he wished. And if he was to do so, he could charge a halfpenny to each customer going over the bridge. So that's what he did. He got a construction company together. They built the bridge, and he got a 100-year contract where he could charge each person walking over this bridge a halfpenny, hence the name, the Hapenny Bridge. So there you go, folks. Hope you like that story. True story. Yeah, this is the Merchants. This is another great pub right here. It's called the Merchants Arch that Suzanne's mentioning there. I'll just show it to you. And that is actually the entrance in to Temple Bar, the most famous night hub in all of Dublin. But we're not going through that entrance because we're going to go to the old part of Temple Bar in a little bit. But I'm going to continue walking up along the River Liffey and show you some of the scenes. We're coming up now to, we're leaving Bachelor's Walk, and we're making our way to Ormond Quay along the River Liffey. And this street, of course, right here, is known as Liffey Street, obviously named after the river, Liffey Street. Lots of nice little restaurants and stuff in that street. It's pretty cool. Welcome, everyone's just joined us. Good to see you all. Hope you're all doing well. Okay. Now, the next bridge, a little bit further up here, I'll go back onto the boardwalk here for a minute. And the next little bridge, Ormond, famous 80s, 90s raves, yeah. Lots of little raves clubs around here back in the 90s, yeah. Even 80s. But this is the second pedestrian bridge on earth. This was actually the Millennium Bridge. And this was completed in December 1999, just in time for the new millennium. Hence the name, the Millennium Bridge. Another pedestrian bridge going over the Liffey. Now we're coming up over to my right. You're going to see, now it's got to be the smallest Little Italy anywhere in, of any European country, I'd say, anywhere. It's got to be the smallest Little Italy. But it is Little Italy over here, where you got a bunch of Italian restaurants all over. But not many. I'd say there's probably 10 in all. As I say, nothing compared to like New York City or any of these other places or even other European cities. But there is Italian restaurants everywhere, not just around here in the Little Italy part. They're scattered all over the place. Irish people love Italian food. What's the number one selling food in the world, folks? The number one selling food in the world is what? So there's our Little Italy there, folks. Through that gateway. Through that archway. Very small. In the world, they said, Declan. Linda, fair play to you. Pizza is correct. Number one selling food in the world is pizza. That's why you got them companies that are so wealthy. Papa John's and what? Domino's and many, many others. You're not going to believe this. Dublin has, this is, I'm not kidding you when I tell you this, but Dublin has the busiest Domino's in the whole entire world. It's in a suburb called Tallaght. It's by far and away Dublin's biggest suburb. It's a huge community. If it was a city, it would be the fourth biggest city in all of Ireland. That's how big the community of Tala is. But the Domino's Pizza there is Domino's busiest franchise of all of Domino's pizzas across the world. It's hard to believe right here in Ireland, but it's true. But then again, it's the only Domino's in all of Tala. And Tala probably has, I don't know, there's got to be 100,000 people or more living in Tala. I'm looking at this hotel right here because this is the hotel where Suzanne stays. This is the Morrison. Are you still on, Suzanne, or did you leave? Can't believe it. She left it as soon as I show her the hotel. And she's going to be staying here when she comes, I think, on the 19th of October. The Morrison Hotel is a lovely, lovely hotel. It's a 4-star hotel, but in my opinion, it should be 5-star because it really is a lovely hotel. And what a great location, looking over the River Liffey. I mean, it really is nice. Okay, you are here. There you go. Tala. It's T-A-L-L-A-G-H-T. T-A-L-L-A-G-H-T. Joyce. Not Talak. Tala. T-A-L-L-A-G-H-T. Tala. Tala. There you go, Una. Thanks very much, Una. So there you go. We're coming up here, folks, to another bridge named after one of Ireland's greatest politicians. He was before Daniel O'Connell's time, back in the mid-1950s to the late 1950s and early 1800s. And his name is Henry Grattan. So this is the Henry Grattan Bridge right here. He was the leader of the old Irish Parliament, which is housed there across the road from Trinity College. And he was a brilliant politician. He was a great orator. And his goal was to try and get legislative freedom for Ireland, economic rights, economic reform, home rule, independence for Ireland. And he was the leader of the Irish contingent in the old Irish Parliament. But with the Act of Union in the year 1800, which was brought into effect in 1801, all Irish affairs were to be moved here from Dublin and to be conducted in Westminster. And poor old Henry Grattan had to leave Ireland and go to Westminster. And he died there 20 years later at the age of 74, still fighting for Irish legislative freedom, for economic rights for the poor Irish people. And his work was continued on by the great Daniel O'Connell, where we see O'Connell Street named after. Now we're coming up right here to a junction of Ormond Quay and Capel Street. And Capel Street, okay, I'm driving back from Buffalo. Very good, Suzanne. Great city, Buffalo. The Buffalo Bills are doing very well lately in the NFL. This right here, folks, is Capel Street. And this is probably the most diverse street in all of Dublin. If you walk down this street, which used to be a traffic street where cars can go by, and just recently they made it just pedestrianised it all. But there's restaurants from nearly every country in the world on this street. You got your Chinese, your Japanese, your Korean, your African, Nigerian, Brazilian, Polish, Lithuanian, Latvian, you name the country. And they have a restaurant on this street full of diversity. Some great, great restaurants. It would be a great place to do a foodie tour if I get a chance. You know something? One of my shoelaces is untied. Hope I don't trip over, but I can't lay this because it's too windy. If I was to lay this thing down, it would fall over. So I'm just going to have to hope I don't trip over. Here's a nice view of the River Liffey right here, folks. Nice postcard photograph there for you. Looking down at the Millennium Bridge and the Hapenny Bridge. What the one? Capel Street. C-A-P-E-L. Capel Street. Capel. With all the restaurants on it. Capel. Thanks, Una. Una's a local. She's from Dublin, so Una is putting that in there for me. She's helped me out. Thanks very much, Una. Appreciate it. So there you go. If you look at this beautiful building right here that I'm facing at right now, that is the Clarence Hotel. And I've got a great story to tell you about that when we get a little bit further around Temple Bar. It's a great story. It's a beautiful hotel. And you won't believe who owns it. Don't give it away. Oh, thank you. Camera worked very good today, says James. Thank you very much. Why, it wasn't good before? Here's this guy messing again with me. Folks, don't listen to him. He's a buddy of mine. Dime coffee. Yeah, this is the music cafe right here. It's pretty cool. This is Dollard and Company. This is a fantastic place right here. They got it's a great food place, great bakery in here. Some great Italian food in as well. There's a great wine bar in there as well. Huge selection of wines. It's a real upmarket marketplace right here. In the outskirts of Temple Bar. This is Wellington Quay. We're going to go across this road right here and bring you into the oldest part of Temple Bar. Lamppost there again. Lamppost. How's that, Linda? I take these lampposts for granted because you walk by them all day long. Down a bit. Beautiful. Well, I have a little bit of time before the light goes green. Here it is now. As I say, we're moving into Parliament Street right here. I'm going to take in the oldest part of the city and the oldest part of Temple Bar. I'm going to go over to the right over here. And that is... how old? Well, these lamps will be more or less from Victorian times. So they'd be between 1830 and 1901. But I guess there would have been a lot of them put up since then and before that period as well. But they are known as Victorian lampposts or lamps. Victorian era. So take a new look. The old city. Because this is the old city right here. As you see the cobblestone streets. These streets are over 1,000 years old. As I say, this is Temple Bar. But we're in the older section of Temple Bar. This is the less busy section. A lot of people will not come down this far of Temple Bar. Because at the heart of Temple Bar, where all the bars are, where all the pubs are, is behind me and down a little bit further. But I want to show you something of interest right here. This is why I came down this street right here. And this is quite extraordinary, this place. This is over here, the Smock Alley Theatre. I'll just show it to you here in a minute. This is the Smock Alley Theatre. I'm trying to give you a better look at this. I'll zoom back out. So this dates back to 1662, folks. This is by far and away the oldest theatre in Dublin, as I say. Dates back to 1662, when it was known as the Theatre Royal. Today it's known as the Smock Alley Theatre. This is the back entrance to it. And it's a very, very small theatre. It only holds 178 people, but still going strong today, still in use. So there you go. Mythical hippocampus, half horse, half fish. What a beautiful city, Nora. Yes, indeed, it's beautiful. It's fantastic. Okay, so we're going to make our way into the heart of Temple Bar. Tell you a few more stories along the way. Over here to my left is the Gaiety School of Acting. And such notables that have studied acting right here are none other than the great Irish actor Colin Farrell. And also, I don't know if you know a series called, it was on HBO or was it on Netflix, Poldark. And the lead figure of that, of who played Poldark, was Aidan Turner. He also went here. And so did Olivia Wilde. Olivia Wilde was an American, but her father's from County Cork. And she actually studied at Gaiety School of Acting. So there you go. Smock. S-M-O-C-K. Joyce. There you go. Smut would not be a good name, I don't think. Doesn't sound right. There you go, Joyce. Yes, indeed. There's a shop right here. It might still be open. But this is the oldest shop in Dublin. I think it closes at 6 o'clock. We might make it. It's fabulous. Thank you, Flora. Flora's putting it in there. Smockalley.com. There you go. But coming up right here, folks, is the oldest shop in Dublin. It's called the House of Reed. And this House of Reed was originally a cutlery shop, cutlery and knife shop. And I'm going to show you inside. It's absolutely beautiful. This, believe it or not, has only been open up about a year as a coffee shop. But as I say, it's the oldest shop in Dublin. It dates back to 1670, originally a cutlery shop. Now, they still have on display in here the old knives, the cutlery, and they have an old cash register. When they went down into the basement, when they were really doing up this place, they found an old cash register that's probably a couple of 800 years old. How you doing there? How's things? How you keeping? Say hello to the world.
Hello.
These ladies, this lady's from Turkey.
Yes.
And the other lady's from Poland, right? No, is she? She's from Poland. There you go. Anybody here from Poland or Turkey? So look, have a look at the old cutlery right here. These are the old knives that's sold in this shop. The oldest shop in Dublin, said folks, dating back to 1670. And there, the old cash register. And he's in the way. You got some more knives and all kinds of stuff there. These are all the original, what they used to sell in here. But it is an absolutely beautiful shop. Very well displayed. Lovely presentation. They sell their own coffees and teas and everything as well. Really is beautiful. Isn't it, folks? Beautiful presentation. That's right, Joyce. Sorry, here's the old cash register, look. And they got some. This is the original cutlery here as well, look. Some more. 1670, folks, the House of Reed. Ladies, have a great day. Thank you. Take care. Thank you. Bye. That's the old City Hall building right there. Beautiful, beautiful building. It dates back. It was actually established between 1670 and 1680. Sorry, 1770 and 1780. City Hall. A lot of weddings take place in that particular building right there. Sorry. But we're going to make our way, folks, down into... We're going to make our way down into the heart of Temple Bar. As I say, the nightclub here in Dublin. And very, very popular among tourists. Although you will get some locals come here as well. But it is a little pricey. You'll pay more for a pint here than you will anywhere else in Dublin. Because the reason for it is that every single pub have music all day long. From like 11 a.m. the morning till 2 o'clock in the morning. And they have to be paid. And in order to pay them, guys, they have to charge a little more for the pints. This is the Porter House right here. This is the oldest craft beer house in Dublin. It was established in 1998. You won't get a pint of Guinness in here. It's probably the only pub in all of Dublin where you won't get a pint of Guinness. Because it's all craft beer. And most of the beers are their own brands. Porter House brands. Really nice. I actually did a tour here on Saturday night on the second floor. Hi, King. Good to see you. Yeah, Nior loves the Porter House. Yeah, so I did a music tour here on Saturday night. The band was absolutely amazing. They were called Slither. Slither. And Slither is the name for the hurley ball when you play hurley, one of the Irish national sports. Now, remember I was showing you a little bit earlier when we were along by the quays, I was showing you the Clarence Hotel. Well, I showed it to you from the front, a beautiful building. This is it from the back. And I have a nice story to tell you. Anybody want to hear a story? Give me a thumbs up. Get excited if you want to hear a story, folks. Slither. That's right, Gregory. Slither. Ooh. Okay, looks like we got some takers on the story. We got people that want to hear a story. This is wonderful, folks. Wonderful. So the story is about this hotel here, the Clarence Hotel. This is the back of it, right? So everybody's heard of U2, the great band, right? Everybody's heard of U2, I'm sure. One of the greatest bands in the world. Well, in the late 1970s, around 1977, they were young fellas and they were playing a gig around town. And they came here to meet a friend of theirs in the Clarence Hotel. But they would have been scruffily dressed, probably unshaven and what have you, long hair. So the bartender refused them service. And when they were leaving, Bono turned around to the bartender and he said to the bartender, next time we'll be in here, we will own this hotel. Next time we come by here, we will own this hotel. And he was a man of his word. About 15, 20 years later, U2, Bono and The Edge bought this hotel and they still own it. I think they only own 50% of it now. I think they sold out 50% to hoteliers. Now, these guys had no interest in running a hotel, but they did it because they said they would. Quite remarkable, huh? Yeah, that's a true story. The Clarence Hotel here in Dublin, owned by U2, because they were a feud service and they said that they would come back and buy it. There you go. Had a drink there last May, says Catherine. There you go, Catherine, yes. Good to see you, Catherine. Catherine, of course, was around Dublin City. I took her around for a walk around, about 3-hour walk. We had a great time. And we went into the Temple Bar for a pint. And we're going there just in a few minutes, folks. So get excited about that. We're going in there to listen to some nice, hopefully, trad or folk music. This is Rory Gallagher corner here. Rory Gallagher was one of Ireland's greatest ever guitar players. Absolutely exceptional. He was actually asked by the Rolling Stones to be their lead guitarist, but he turned them down, started his own band, Rory Gallagher Band. Now, he was one of the world's greatest guitarists, one of the greatest guitarists in history. And in fact, what's his name? I got a mental block. The left-hander, Jimi Hendrix, was on a radio show and he was being interviewed. And this would have been, obviously, late 1960s or whatever. And he was asked, how does it feel, Jimmy, to be the greatest guitar player in the world? And with that, Jimi Hendrix turned to the interviewer and said, I wouldn't know. You'd have to ask Rory Gallagher. How about that? Paddy Max, Fitzsimons, Temple Bar. Lots of all these are all great watering holes, as we call them. All great spots for a beer and listen to some music. And here's the Temple Bar. The Norseman right here. This is the oldest bar here. It dates back to 1696. And obviously this is named after the Norsemen, the Vikings. They arrived here at Wood Quay and built their own settlement in the year 840, nearly 1,200 years ago. Hi, Candice, how are you? Good to see you. Guinness Times, says Gregory. Yes, indeed. Paddy Max probably sell hamburgers. They do food in there, all right. They do sell hamburgers, but that wouldn't be their main food on the list. So this is the famous Temple Bar. This area, Temple Bar, or Temple Bar, I should say, is named after Sir William Temple. And we are in what would have been his gardens. He owned a huge, big mansion on this site, all of this area. It would have been a massive, massive, big, like 400-acre estate or whatever. And he came here from England in 1599. From 1607 to 1627, he was the provost of Trinity College. And this whole area, say, is named after him, Sir William Temple, Temple Bar. But this is the most famous pub in Temple Bar, the Temple Bar in Temple Bar. So there you go. So folks, you've probably seen photographs of this. It's one of the most photographed places in all of Dublin. We also have here, folks, if I can see it, this is the World Cam right here. See it? See the camera right here underneath that pharmacy sign? That's a World Cam. I think there's only two of them in Dublin. There's one in O'Connell Street and there's one right here. So I am being filmed across the world at this very time, across the whole entire world right now. How about that? Hello, world. Are you ready for some music, folks? Look, all the tourists taking photographs. This is how famous this place is. It's a huge place inside. There's about four or five bars in here. As I said, myself and Catron went in here for a pint, didn't we, Catron? And I'm going to bring you into the whiskey bar in a little bit. Now, I hope these musicians are not on a break. It often happens to me. When I go into these places, they happen to be on a break the very time I'm in the pub. So I hope that doesn't happen. But anyway, let's go in. Can you believe it? He's on a break. So. It looks like this guy's finishing up, and there's probably another band starting in a few minutes. Listen, we go to some other pub. I'll go to some other pub and listen. Yeah, he's finishing up. What a shame. Sorry. We'll go somewhere else. I want to show you the whiskey bar. They've got this fantastic whiskey bar in here. And it's all part of Temple Bar itself. Frank's coming in January. Okay, Frank, good stuff. Look me up if you do come. How you doing, boss? How are you? You're still here? You having fun? You're sampling all the whiskey. What whiskey is that you're drinking? Well, you're drinking the whole bottle. Fair play to me. Connemara, huh? Connemara, yeah. There's all kinds of great whiskeys in here. There's actually two different whiskeys here where it's like €300 a shot. €300. And that, what was that whiskey that you showed me earlier? He's going to get this whiskey. It's Middleton is probably the biggest distiller I won. It's part of Jameson, right, Middleton? It's from this distillery down in Cork, Middleton and County Cork. But this, a shot of this, what's it called again?
Method of Madness, 31-year anniversary.
Method of Madness, 31-year anniversary. A shot of this costs?
€300,
folks. Can you buy me a shot? Can you give me? So who wants to give me €300 to buy a shot? Any takers, folks? No? Okay. Thanks anyway. Look, no harm in asking. It's a beautiful whiskey bar. It really is nice. It's lovely. There you go. You know something? I came the wrong time. Your man is on his break from the music. So I'm going to have to go to another music bar. Cool. Okay. We'll see you in a bit. Thanks very much. Take care. See you later. Bye. Thank you. Folks, €300 a shot. There's actually another bottle there as well that's under lock and key. That's something, I think it's €400 or something a shot. But suddenly seized up. Otherwise, this, someone was saying that also. Well, someone was complaining about it yesterday. There's some girl that made zero on tips in a really, really beautiful area close to Rome. It was on the Facebook page today, and she made zero in tips. And some people said that they weren't able to tip because the tip button wasn't working or something. I don't know. I haven't even seen any tips come in for me yet either, so I don't know what the story is. Thanks for letting me know, Gregory. Looks like I might be working for free today. Okay, Nino, take care. Thank you, Catherine. So it is working. Well, maybe it's working for some people. Thanks, Catherine. Appreciate it. Thanks, Fraser. Appreciate that. Let's go into the old storehouse right here. And just as it starts to rain. What great timing this is, folks. About to start pouring down rain. And, okay, thank you, Linda. Appreciate it. They're working fine. Great stuff. Thank you. Thanks, Poppy. This is the Badass Temple Bar. Actually, a young 18 or 17-year-old Sinead O'Connor used to work in here as a waitress. How about that? Until she went on to worldwide fame. We're going into the storehouse. This is a great pub. Hopefully some music on here right now. No, I didn't ask permission. I was only going to the Temple Bar pub. That was it. But there might be no musicians on yet. How you doing, man? How's it going? How are you? How you doing? You're good, you're okay. Yeah, I think I did see that, Candace. There you go, Gregory, yeah. My timing's bad with the music tonight. How's it going? That's right, Joyce. She had my bags last night. We fly. Thanks, Nora. See where I was 98. And I'm gonna be high. It's a child by the it's my wife, it's lonely out in space. At such a time, I miss mine. It's gonna be a long, long time to touch down, brings me back again to five. Not in mind if you can't hide. Oh, no, no, no. I'm a rocket man. Rocket man burning out his feet of even though. It's gonna be a long, long time to touch down, bring me right against you, fine. Not in mind if you can't hide. Oh, no, no, no. The old storehouse, Eric. Burning the old storehouse. The old storehouse. Let's name it. It's the one there to raise them. I don't silence, I don't understand. It's just my job 5 days a week. A rocket man, a rocket man. It's gonna be a long, long time to touch down, brings me right again to you, right? Not the mind if you try out, no, 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 no. Just have a rocket mile. Rocket mile, burning on the streets of people, no. Think it's gonna be a long, long time. Thank you very much. I think it's gonna be a long, long time. Yes, Terry. Music is great, Terry. I think it's gonna be a long time. Thank you. Good stuff. Thank you. My viewers loved it.
Thank you.
I've got live streaming.
Professional living setup you got there.
It's a live stream. People are watching from all over the world. Say hello.
Hello, everyone.
What's your name?
Simon.
G-Y-N-N.
Look me up.
G-I-N-N. Simon Jin. G-Y-N-N.
Very uncommon there.
Simon Jin.
Strange saving.
Thanks, Simon. Appreciate it. Thanks, Simon. Appreciate it. Thank you. Live stream. Gin. Gin and orange. Gin and tonic. Gordon's gin. That's the best gin. Gordon's gin. Ticket's starting to rain out here. Okay, folks. That's about all I got for you. I hope you enjoyed the tour. Thanks so much for coming on. Tomorrow I'm doing a tour of Rathmines. It's a suburb of Dublin. It's a very, very famous suburb of Dublin. It's not far from the city. And we're going to go around to all the historic landmarks of Rathmines. Hope you can join us. Known as the Flatlands of Dublin, because once upon a time, most of the homes there were occupied by students living there as accommodation who were going to college in Dublin. And most of them were from the country, so most of them were Irish people. This would have been before foreigners ever came to Ireland, as the country was pretty poor at that time. So, and the accommodation would have been very reasonable around Rathmines. But they're beautiful townhouses, they're lovely, lovely Georgian houses, Victorian houses. Today, it costs an absolute fortune to live around there. And today, probably the majority of people living there wouldn't even be from Ireland, they're from all over the world. So it'd be really, really very interesting for you to come and watch that tour. It starts at 6:30 Irish time. Check your local listings, probably around 1:30 East Coast time, United States and Canada. And hope you can make it for that. And then come Friday, I have Oscar Wilde and George in Dublin, and featuring Merrion Square Park. It's a beautiful tour, folks. You'll really like it. I'm going to be discussing a lot about the beautiful Georgian buildings around Dublin. And we'll also go into Merrion Square Park, tell you about the life and times of Oscar Wilde, tell you about the story of Merrion Square, one of the five Georgian squares here in Dublin. Hope you can accompany that Friday. That's at 5:30 Irish time Friday. And then we got music, folk, right here in Temple Bar come Saturday at Irish time, 6:30. And it will be fantastic. We're going to see the Irish Celts. They're absolutely amazing, amazing group. We're going to Temple Bar. Sorry, we're going to Darky Kelly's pub. It will be absolutely fantastic. I hope you can join me for that, folks. As we have here, St. John Gogarty's. Oliver St. John Gogarty's pub. There's music on in here. Here, I'll take you in for one more song, all right, folks? So, Slán Leat, agus Greva Míle Maith Agat. One more song before the road.
Why don't you come on over there? Come on over there. Yes, thank you.
I'm always catching a mid-song or near the end of the song. Stay for one more song, folks, and that's it. All right, Gregory. Gregory's excited. And a fiddle, Julia.
Right, just to celebrate our Lord and Savior's album coming out, Robbie Williams. So,
Angel, great song.
Don't bother getting the album on it, it's terrible.
I was lonely, she was here, we were one.
If there's somebody, Lord, it could be you. She's the one.
Now, I thought that's what you're supposed to say. Lovely bars around here. St. John Gogarty. He was actually a friend of James Joyce's in real life, this guy. And the first chapter of Ulysses, is all about this guy, St. John Gogarty, who this bar is named after. He was Buck Mulligan in the first episode, who lived in the Martello Tower in Sandy Cove in Dublin. And Joyce went to live with him for a while. But he was a crazy character, this guy, Oliver St. John Gogarty. He was an actor, he was a writer, he was a poet, he was all kinds of different stuff, but he was a crazy individual. And Joyce claimed he tried to kill him one night. There you go. So folks, that's all I got for you. Thanks very much for coming on. We'll hopefully see you tomorrow. Thanks for all the tips, appreciate it, for all the contributions. If you'd like to leave a review, I'd really appreciate it if you leave a nice review. Reviews are very, very important to us. Tour guides, it basically lets people know that it's an enjoyable and it's a tour work going on. But if they don't see any reviews, they're more less inclined to go on that tour. So if you can please, if you've never left a review before, please leave a review. It's very important. And I say that for all tour guides because we really, really do appreciate it. It is recognition of our hard work and our preparation and our research and so forth for these tours. So it's real important. If you could please do it. If you're not sure, just go into your previous tours and you'll be able to see where to leave the review. But hopefully you all leave a review. Poppy knows how to, she leaves the most unbelievable reviews. Absolutely fantastic. I really, really appreciate it, Poppy. Just amazing reviews all the time. Not just me, but every tour guide. And we really, really appreciate it. She's lovely, kind words to say about all the tour guides. And they're absolutely amazing reviews. So thanks very much, everyone, folks. Have a great day. Slán leat. Agus go raibh míle maith agat. And we'll see you again soon, folks. Take care. Thank you. Bye.